Welcome back to our special series, What the World Wants from India. The series where we speak with veteran foreign fund managers who have been long watching Indian markets. My guest now is Julian Mayo of Fiera Capital. Julian has been a watcher of and an investor in emerging markets and in India for over three decades now. Julian Mayo, thank you very much for joining us. Well, first up, first the World Bank and now the IMF have been bringing down the global growth forecasts for 2019. Generally, do you think equities is the place to be in 2019? Or do you think smart money will perhaps find equities less rewarding in 2019?
I think Johan has to differentiate a little bit between developed and emerging markets. I think the developed market, bull market, if you like, is slightly long in the tooth and I think is running out of steam. Whereas from the emerging market perspective, the markets obviously had a bad year last year. They had five bad years up until 2016. And so actually, I think emerging markets are relatively well positioned for 2019 based on really recovering valuations and a gradual recovery in their economies.
Let me then concentrate only on emerging markets. It's good to hear that things will be better for this side of the world. But right now we are seeing China reporting its slowest pace of growth in 28 years, we are told. Will not that affect emerging markets growth in general?
I think it will to some extent, although the thing is that the China economy is growing bigger every year by, admittedly, by a smaller amount. So it's growing 6.5% at the moment, but it means that the base is rising the whole time. So the impetus that China can give to the rest of the world continues to be very strong. And I think that applies to a lot of emerging markets.
All right. So in that case, what's your pecking order in emerging markets on the equity side?
That's a very good question. I think China and India feature very highly in that. So we have our biggest overweights in our global emerging markets portfolios are in China and India for different reasons. As you said, the Chinese economy is slowing down, but nonetheless is continuing to grow at a healthy 6%+ growth rate. India is growing at an even faster growth rate of between 7% and 8% on a longer term basis. So those are the two markets really the top of our pecking order. Other than that, you're talking about some of the other faster growing economies such as Indonesia and also areas where there is an economic recovery going on from a low base such as Brazil.
Okay, let me come then straight away to India. Do you get disappointed by the fact that Indian corporate earnings growth has not fired for what, 4 or 5 years now?
Yeah, I think that's the biggest concern we have as bottom-up stock pickers in India is being able to find stocks where there is that growth dynamic and where you are seeing very strong growth. And so I think, for example, the consumer staple sector, which is obviously has been a sort of favourite for investors for a long time, we don't see a huge amount of growth there. And from a bottom-line perspective, we've been disappointed by that. But there are areas of the market where growth rate is strong and where we are seeing the kind of double digit growth rates that one would expect from a high growth economy like India.
Which are those areas?
Well, the financials would be an example. So we see continuous growth in some of the big private banks. So we own, we like HDFC Bank, we own Kotak Mahindra and India Bulls Housing Finance, which is a slightly different business. But nonetheless, we think we see growth in the financial sector there, but also in some of the more, if you like, structural stories, Container Corp of India, which is obviously a rapidly growing long-term case as the whole kind of dedicated freight corridor, comes into place and expands over time. And also, we have a position in agrochemicals business called UPL, which is obviously participating in the longer-term growth dynamic of agricultural chemicals. That's a low-cost producer, and obviously, as the world becomes wealthier, it needs more protein.
Mm. Fair point. It's tempting to go on with questions. Go on with stocks, but I'm interested in your political worries as well. So first, let me come to that. Would you worry that India is going through polls, a general election, and the outcome might disturb the earnings cycle?
To some extent. I mean, normally I'm very enthusiastic about countries that go to the polls. I think democracy is a good thing generally, and I think governance is a key driver of economic prosperity. And but certainly it seems to us that you know, the reforms that the Modi government has put into place over time are going to start paying fruit, bearing fruit. I think that the key thing, obviously, the key, if you like, vulnerability with India economically from a macro perspective is its budget situation, and certainly what needs to happen is that the take of government revenue as a percentage of GDP needs to rise over time, and I think that's probably what's going to happen. But I also think we're at a situation now where, you know, a lot of the heavy lifting, a lot of the difficult work has been done in terms of the GST in particular. And the impression we get is that, although, you know, we're not political analysts per se, is that whatever happens in the election, the forthcoming election, whoever wins the election is going to continue with this broad reformist programme, because ultimately the budget deficit necessitates it.
Okay. Well, actually, that was the real reason for inviting you. There will be a budget in less than 2 weeks. It usually is a vote on account, but this government has kind of hinted that it will announce some kind of a farm program. And there are all-round fears that that might increase the fiscal deficit more than what the bond market can stomach. Is that a worry at all for you?
Yes, I suppose it would be. I mean, we're not sort of privy to the kind of political minutiae that you are in Mumbai or your colleagues are in Delhi. But nonetheless, it seems that would be a concern for us. But again, I think you need to differentiate a little bit between the short and the longer term. And whilst there may be some sort of you know, handouts, if you like, in the run up to the election, I think it's over the longer term, the commitment to narrowing that deficit, I think, is going to continue.
No, more generally, you're not worried about the fact that there is a slightly less respect for things like fiscal deficit, slightly less respect for central banks and their capital and their inmates. Are these broad institutional questions a worry for you at all?
Yes, that's a very good question, because obviously the quality of institutions, the institutional framework is critical, and you know, often in emerging markets we've been very critical of countries that are where you know, central banking has been too politicized, where central bank policy has been far too loose, and I think, you know, Turkey recently over the last 18 months has been a very good example of that. I almost think in India it's gone too much the other way, however. I think that the central bank has been a little bit too hawkish.
Okay.
And actually what was required was a little bit more flexibility, which we now have.
All right. Good. I'm sure the government's very glad to hear that. Okay. Therefore, you know, if there is going to be, some kind of fiscal largesse, would you worry that we could get higher interest rates? Is one of the big arguments is that, as you said, the government, the central bank has been too hawkish. Are you expecting rate cuts, and therefore will that inform the way you pick stocks?
I don't think there's going to be a big movement in the interest rate environment in India, and particularly for the reasons you mentioned earlier. If there is a bit of a fiscal laxity in the short term, that'll obviously put upward pressure on rates at the same time when, you know, fundamentally, perhaps rates should be being reduced. So I don't see there being significant movement either way in rates. Okay. over the shortish term.
Okay, fine. Let me come to the sectors and stocks that you mentioned. You began with private banks, and then you said you also like some of the non-bank companies, housing finance companies. I think you had at some point taken interest in India Bulls Housing as well. Would you continue to persist with non-bank finance companies, especially because they went through a bit of a turmoil in the debt markets last year?
They did, although I think a lot of them were unfairly sold off by association with obviously the bigger concern with IL&FS.
Yeah.
But I think that India Bulls Housing Finance, for example, has made some very clear statements about its liquidity position.
Yes.
and its longer term growth trajectory. So we're not the least concerned about that.
Okay. All right. Which other sectors other than private banks and NBFCs would you take a look at? Public sector banks or corporate facing banks like ICICI and Axis? One argument is that now their period of bad loans is behind them.
Yeah, we would look at the private sector banks in general. We like the governance of the private sector banks as a whole. As I said, we've made our choices, and we're happy with the ones that we own at the moment. But we look throughout the sector. I mean, as for this balance between, you know, consumption or consumer-facing banks and industrial-facing banks, you know, that is something that we look at the whole time. Over time, as India develops, obviously there's growth has got to come from both sides of that. And you know, banks have, you know, one of the, if you like, structural problems with it with India compared with some of the Asian, some Far Eastern markets is that the savings rate and therefore the investment rate is lower than it should be. And obviously, you know, if that rises over time, there's an increased participation in banks, you know, lending both to the consumer sector and also to the industrial sector.
Okay. Finally, what about IT and pharma, the global facing sectors? A couple of IT numbers were excellent, the third quarter numbers.
Yeah, I think they're both areas that we look at. We are probably not as keen as on pharma. Okay. As we are in some of the IT sectors, but certainly IT is an area that we do look at. It's on our radar screen. We look very closely at it.
Okay. Well, this is a pre-budget interview. What, according to you, is the biggest risk that you look out for in India?
Well, I guess in a broad sense, populism, I guess, would be the way to characterize it. It's the concern that we would have across the world, and by the way, more so I think in the West than it is in emerging markets at the moment, is this descent towards populism and therefore its effect on short-term policy making. What we need to see is long-term vision, and I think that's what the government has really been demonstrating over the last 4 years or so in India. So I think it's really what we'd be concerned about is an excessive focus on short-term considerations, and what we're looking for is, as I said, a longer-term vision.
Okay. Just a final question. If, for whatever reason, the current BJP government is not returned to power after the May elections, would that change your outlook on India? Would you buy less, more?
Well, I think it depends really on the manifestos and the statements that come out after the election from whoever, you know, who obviously takes power. But as I said, our view is that the reforms are of a nature that the opposition would also, in a broad sense, carry into office when they were to win the election. So we would really look at what the incoming government says and respond accordingly. But I don't see any reason at the moment to be pulling a lever and to say let's reduce significantly our position in India. But you know, by contrast, I'd be minded in the longer term to increase further our positions in India.
Julian Mayo, it was a pleasure speaking with you. We do hope we can speak with you yet again after the budget and definitely after the elections as well.
Thanks.
Well, that's Julian Mayo of Fiera Capital, and the key takeaways: likes private banks and NBFCs, which he thinks are unfairly targeted. Also likes Indian Infotech and not terribly worried about elections, definitely worried about populism. Well, that's the first of our What the World Wants series. We will be back with more in just a few days.